Oh, Emily Francis, I am so glad you're with us from
Get I'm glad to be here.
Oh my gosh.
Hello, 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 everybody from beautiful sunny Malta.
Yeah. Malta, yeah, just make us jealous. But while we're being jealous of Malta, I want to just tell everyone about Emily. She is a highly sought after speaker, author, wellness expert, and I can't wait to talk to you more about that. Your whole approach is that wellness is whole body and balance is key, and kindness and loving yourself and all things that we love. And you also have an internet radio show. And I mean, there's 1,001 more things, but it's a short interview. So that's my cold notes on Emily. Is there anything you would add to that brief introduction about yourself?
That radio show is called All About Healing on Healthy Life Radio. It's every Wednesday, 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern time. Tune in, follow me, come and see me over there.
Awesome. We will. And we'll make sure that link is in your event so people can check it out and find it easily.
And here's what I need you to do, Emily. Please hold that book up. That is so wonderful.
So the Healing Ourselves Whole.
It's another HCI book. Look at, let me see that cover up close. That, oh, that is nice. That
see the person in the tree and the.
Didn't that turn out beautiful? Let me see the back of it too. Just so I can
see. This is the advanced reader's copy, so this is not what other people will see.
Okay, hold the front up one more time. Look at that. Okay, tell us what the book's about, and how many books are you going to give us, give away?
You'll have to talk to HCI, because I can't send things from Malta, but inside. So I'm the creator of the somatic emotion chart, which somatic is a fancy term for body. So your body emotion chart, and that is the heavy four emotions that your body holds, your action bridge, and then your fabulous four emotions that your body holds. So of the nearly 20 years of body work that I've been doing and more than 20 years of study into the body and physiology, what I've come to realize is that when your hands are on a person's actual body, the emotions that are stored there are very different than what you would Google on the emotion wheel and the feeling wheel and things that are under cognitive. So when I've been doing this work for a very long time, the body speaks to me. And so I created the somatic emotion chart, and it's actually right here in the front of the book. So it's really easy to find. If you can see that.
Yeah.
Go this way. Yeah, and this is the entire, this is the book. This is every chapter. So we go through all the emotions from the somatic emotion chart. And in each chapter is a very lengthy meditation followed by a journal. And the journals are extremely specific. So the journals, they'll have a picture of a body. You'll X marks the spot where the message came from, what part of your body, and then fill out. You're actually going like 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So what are the things you saw? What are the things you heard? What did you smell? What could you touch? And kind of bring back those memories. But the big thing to me is, and I love that at least the back of the cover talks about it. It's not just about healing trauma, because the subtitle is An Interactive Guide to Release Pain and Trauma by Utilizing the Wisdom of the Body. But the whole other half of the book is the happy and the joy and learning how to become connected inside and then taking that out into the world, which is being empowered. So I don't want to forget that there's a really good side in healing, and it doesn't always have to be to drive down into that trauma space, though we do that in order to get to the happy.
I can tell you're really proud of this.
I'm so thrilled. It's, you know what? It's my simplest work, to be really honest. It's the work you do alone. Mm-hmm. It's the work you do by yourself. So my other books are just chock full of research. And there's still some research in here just to back up what I'm saying. But it's really the work right now when people are lost, trying to redefine their life, trying to figure out what's next, stepping out back into the sunlight when the world kind of opens back up. We are all in a place, no matter what, everybody's in a place of re-identifying who we are, what we want to be doing, and how short life and how precious life really is, which, by the way, Chris, I almost started crying, and I was like, oh my gosh, do not let me, because I was watching your interview before I got on, and I was like, please don't let me start this crying, but it's, I mean, you've been through a tremendous shift, and I send you so much love and support and healing. And I know that you always put on the brave face and the big smile, but I work with people that are in the grieving. So when I put my hands on somebody, they let the guard down. And so
I just heard you invite me to Malta. Send me my plane ticket.
You are welcome.
Emily, I am coming to Malta for healing. Special.
There's an apartment downstairs, so you have a place to stay. You're welcome and invited.
Honestly, Malta, Julia, is a dream. I would love it. I would be absolutely honored to work with you and to go through that process, because I just love and adore you. Everything you say hits me in the heart, makes sense. And I'm like, yes, Emily, tell us more. And I think it's such valuable, such incredible work. So sorry, enough about me. Back to you.
You know what? I just think it's so important that we don't leave our body behind in our healing process, because you can't just get clear in the mind. You can't just change your actions and behaviors. You have to go down deep. If you were in a car accident and what happens is people don't remember the actual details, because it's the gift of the mind to eject out of the body. But your body doesn't have that ability. So we have to dive into that body, because it's got all the truths. It's got all the truth. So we don't want to just move forward into healing and leave the body part out. So may I highly recommend a really trustworthy, very respectful, responsible, clinical body worker that can help you.
And it's,
I look for the words wellness and clinical. I look for those words. If I see those, I'm like, all right, I'm in. I'll go.
Yeah. Beautiful. And I would like to be in the luggage or something on that trip.
Come on.
Okay. As soon as the world opens up, that's happening. And you're all invited. I'm invited. Every single one of you.
Only if Emily lets Chris and I take over her blog for a day or two.
Oh my God. Yes, please. I'll let you take it over for more than that, because blogging is harder than I thought. I loved blogging and I still like it. But this is what I wrote about the other day. I'm trying to write the book or pitch, I'm trying to write what I will pitch at the same time that I'm blogging. So the blogging is like an appetizer and the main courses are in the book. And I don't want to say the same things. And in the book, I'm so deeply honest. And in the blog, I'm not ready to be that deeply honest. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So yeah, come on, come take it over.
I would love to be there and write on your blog for about what do you think, Chris? A week or two, maybe? But what blog is it?
Oh, it's mymaltalife.com.
Yeah, check
mymaltalife.com. Because I'm here. We moved sight unseen, never having visited. In the middle of a lockdown, we were the last people allowed in this country before they shut the doors. We moved here with 2 children, 4 animals, my husband. We came here right after quarantine. We had to quarantine, and we literally designed our entire life on the internet. Our realtor was over here taking videos, showing us everything. We chose where to live, what house, signed a year lease, all online. But our boss was already here, and he's magic. We always say that he's magic. And they led the way and got it in, because the boss's wife wanted to move someplace warm. I wanted out. I wanted a new life. I really did. I was living in Southern Georgia, and I just, when you're not in the right place and you just keep banging on the doors and you just know you're not in the right place, and it's not a place that's conducive to getting into the right place. And so I just was like, I want to live in a country where the food is all GMO free. I want to live where it's warm. I had a box of things. I thought it was the Caribbean. And then all of a sudden our boss and his wife were on a trip to Italy, got sidetracked, came to Malta, and she goes, I could live here. He was on the horn, meeting with the prime minister, got a grant, and we were on our way. And my husband looked at me and he was like, okay, what do you think, Malta? And I was like, tell him yes. And we were, and they could move pretty quick, because they didn't sell their houses. But we had to sell our house and get ready for, we had 4 animals. And my 2 dogs are 65 pounds and 85 pounds. They're not little babies you stick on the plane. Though I did turn my cat into a therapy cat and did put her on the plane.
It's adorable.
That is beautiful. We love that story. And I'm so proud of you for that big yes, and your husband and your whole family. And what an amazing thing. I think that's so many people maybe think they're stuck or they don't see a way out or whatever. And it must have been hard. I know you're like, yes, but you had already been thinking about it. But for people who are feeling stuck,
I did it years ago when I was single and I moved across the country. And I got what I thought was my dream job. And then I got there and it was just me and my dog. And about 2 weeks I was flying high. I'm so proud of myself. Look at me. I'm such a big girl now. I'm like a grown up. And then it was like the company was really unorganized. I still hadn't started work. They gave me a key to an apartment where people were living in. I walked in on a family. They were just one thing after another. And I'm up 18 hours away from my house. And the self-talk went from, I'm so proud of you, to, you're not getting out of here. You're not getting out of here alive. You're not, and the self-talk became just unbelievably bad. And it was so lonely. So I had that nervous excitement coming here, because here was with my favorite people in the world. I have my husband, I have my children, I have my pets. Everything that was in my home transported with me. But it still is that thing of talking about being excited or talking about the opportunity to up and leave and start whole new is one thing. Doing it is something entirely different. And so that was, it was, I had that in the back of my mind of, don't do what you did before. Now you have your people with you. You're not alone. You're not going to be lonely, and you're going to be brave. But I find myself constantly writing, mostly kids stuff, but writing to my kids, and that being called to be brave. And I keep saying, like, what does that mean? It doesn't mean you don't feel the fear. It doesn't mean you're fearless. It doesn't mean you're super strong. It means that you do feel all your feelings, and you're going to go forward anyway. Because I wrote a letter to my kids. They were going to a school that we couldn't even go in because of COVID. I couldn't tour the school. I couldn't meet her teachers. I couldn't go to the classroom. I couldn't go to the school. And that, designing your life in that aspect, is terrifying. And so I became the van supervisor. So I go on the school van every morning, because they have chaperones here in Malta on every public van. And I found out that ours didn't have one this year because of COVID, because they're usually old retired women. And so they didn't have one. And I was like, can I do it? And they're like, and then they tried to pay me. And I was like, oh no, I'm not allowed to work here. I don't have a work visa. And they kept like, what can we do? And I said, here's what I heard from my husband's boss. You have two choices. You can put the money back into the school, or you can give it to charity, but you are not putting that money in my hands. But the fact that you let me get on the van every day and see where my children go and know that they got there safe in a place that I didn't even know where the school was, you know, I mean, that's terrifying. Mm-hmm. So now I'm the van supervisor, and honestly, I love it because I'm the fly on the wall.
I just want to ask, in everything that you're just describing, and going back to the Women's Day Conference here for a minute, and I wanted to talk about your daughters. Some of the things you've said have sort of have hinted at that these are powerful messages for your daughters. I've heard you say brave and so forth. So can you tell us how meaningful that move is, and with your daughters and so forth, and maybe somehow tie that into to Women's Day?
Well, what I can tell you is that the education system here is not broken. And I know you know what I'm talking about. It's the school that we dream about. It's the schooling all across the country here that's 40 years ago. Kids still write in cursive. The kids are still really kind and welcoming. There's a lot of international children and a lot of local children. Putting my kids in here has been, I have yet to find the right word. Last year, we moved to Southern Georgia, and it was one of my children's absolute destruction. This year has been whatever the opposite word is to complete and utter destruction. That's where she's at. It's an entirely new person. It's a whole reconstruction in a way that is so blissfully incredible and so daringly happy. And she's becoming so brave and confident. She's painfully shy. And there's a little boy in her class. She's 8. And she kept talking about this boy. And, you know, we can't meet anybody because of COVID. So we have this mom's WhatsApp group of a bunch of strangers. And then I figured out who that mom was. And I private messaged them like, hey, my child's really shy. And she talks about your son, that he's really nice to her. Do you think sometime we could get together? Well, now they spent Christmas with us, New Year's with us. They are spending my daughter's birthday with us. We've become like really close because they're also from Brazil. And what he said to my child with no adult around, so our kids told us this, he looked at her and he said, listen, if you feel shy, just tell me and I'll bring you into any group you want. Because he's really popular with the kids, but he's got this heart that, I know it's a Women's Day Conference, but I've yet to meet little boys or really most men that have the kind of genuine, gentle heart of that child that could say, hey, I got you. I'm going to help you make this great. And that's a lot of the girls here too. But I'll tell you, here's how I can tie it into the Malta and the Women's Conference. The women here are strong and proud, not proud, arrogant, strong and proud. They love their heritage. They love their country. They are proud of who they are. And you can see it in the children. So I'm on the van and I'm literally giving my girls these talks of, we're going to have to stand up for ourselves more. Do you see how all these little girls and even the adults, they really stick up for themselves? Like, it's just a different culture here. And the women do not take that kind of, like I said to my husband, these women, it was a whole deal at the grocery store. And I'm texting my husband going, this is it. This is where my nervous breakdown is going to happen, because these women are in front of me with these baskets of things to get gift wrapped for Christmas. And I have this sweet basket because I'm in charge of the teacher gift, and they keep getting in front of me. And then finally it's my turn and the woman's wrapping my basket. And this other woman comes up and goes, you didn't wrap my whiskey bottle. And they unwrap my basket and scoot it away. And I'm like, and I'm texting my husband. This is it. This is it. This is my breakdown. This is what's going to happen right here in the grocery store. And I walked away thinking, the woman that we rent our house from is such a badass. She's a badass. So we call her our inner and her first name. So my husband's always like, you got to reach in and get your inner woman. But it's her name. I don't want to say it just in case. But I kept thinking, if she was here, she never would have let that happen. She never would have let them treat me like that. And then there's this point where you go, or I could do that in a calm, comfortable, kind way. And I said to my husband, I'm texting him and I'm like, who did they get the message from that Americans are really nice pushover people? And he was like, I think they got it from you. Did you not just let them do that? Like, that's not true. I'm not that way. But I have been, you know, it's humbling to be in another country. And even though English is one of the languages spoken here, it is humbling to come here and not be the American. You know, they don't care that you're the American. In fact, right now, because of COVID, you were called the dirty American. Nobody's looking at you and going, yeah, but they're all saying, hey, you're from America. Cool. Like, it's a decent, some people really welcome you. Some people are indifferent, but nobody's been rude. Cool. But watching the women here gives me a little bit of oomph.
Confidence.
Yeah. They don't play here. They do not play. They're not going to let you step on them the way that I have let a lot of people step on me in the years.
I love hearing
Well, let's throw some glitter up for those Maltese women, courage and strength all day long. That is
they are cool. And you, I wish I could imitate their accents. It's a sing-songy English. It's not like British. It's their own accent. And it's so lovely. And to see all these children speak like it, it's really
practice.
It's very, I can only say one sentence that my friend said. It has a cuss word in it. So.
No, don't do that. We're live.
So I'm not going to, it's lovely. And the people here are, you know what, even this, I think I told you this maybe, that I got lost and this man got out of his car. And in because of my Southern mindset, he gets out of the car. We're on this dirt road. It's just me, him, and my kids. So in my head, I'm like, okay, I'm going to run over his feet. Then I'm going to run over his knees. You know, whatever I got to do to get out of here safe. And he's telling me to roll down the window. And I roll down the window and he's like, miss, your car's too nice for this road. I'll help you out. I'm like, I almost ran you over because I have such a protection. And in where I came from, you had to be really, really vigilant with your children. And here, it's a very small island. So people, and it's 98% Catholic here. And it's a very family, very, very family. And so people take care of their own here. And so you don't have that, the fears that you come with from a big country. It's cool.
All right, Miss Emily Francis, I hate to do
this. Oh, we're already done.
We're out of time, yeah. And so, Chris, which question, yes or best, do we ask Emily?
I'll do best, because I know she's out there living her best. And what we want to talk about is what makes you feel your best. We've been talking about the incredible yes, and obviously one of your yeses is the yes to move to Malta. So what do you do, Emily, to feel your best?
When I feel my best, I'm exercising regularly. Yeah. I'm eating less sugar. I'm meditating daily, at least once a day. I'm praying, which are not the same thing, but they're closely related. I'm spending time outside and I'm giving thanks, but it has to be all of it. I have to be eating better. I have to be more conscious. I have to be doing the exercise. Without it, I don't feel quite like I moved here and hired a trainer, and I haven't done that before. And I work out Monday, Wednesday, Friday, because you can afford things here that I couldn't afford in the States. And so I have this professional football, soccer in America, football player, trainer, and it's really lovely. But without that, I don't know that I could feel my best because one of those parts would be missing.
Yeah, beautiful. All right.
I love that, the holistic answer. And speaking of whole, there it is, healing ourselves whole. And that is coming out
May 11th. And it's on pre-order now. So yes, please, right. It's coming out Kindle, paperback, and audio all on May 11th. So that's my first audiobook ever.
Sometimes I don't think listeners understand what pre-order means. And so I really want to go through that really fast. But it's really important to an author with a new book out to pre-order. Pre-orders aren't fun. Yeah, they're it's not like, oh, I need to pre-orders. They can determine the life of the book, the well-being of the actual book and the author and so forth. It's so important to go pre-order.
So please do. Please, please. And thanks for having me on, ladies. I love you both. I really appreciate you spending this time with me and including me in this. And I can't wait to see you again soon.
Sounds real good. Bye for now, Emily. And bye, ladies. We'll see everybody else really soon with our next guest in a couple of minutes.
Bye.